sont comme le bon vin. Ils donnent de la joie ou bien du chagrin. Affaibli par la faim, je suis malheureux.
Let's do this. Hey guys, Noah here.
And Chelsea.
We're going to be talking about self-portraits today.
Awesome. So Noah, you just made your first self-portrait.
It was excruciating.
I think
the hardest part for me is starting it, because an outline looks nothing, at least for the way that I do art. When I do the outline, it doesn't look super like what it's going to end up looking like. So I was like looking at this outline, I was like, that does not look like me. That's not what I look like.
I feel the same way. It's terrifying because you're just like, that has no soul. That is not what I look like. Yeah.
I mean, it literally is a deconstructed version of yourself. It's really hard to look at that and be like, oh, I can see where this is going to eventually end up. Or more so, I didn't mess this up. Because my initial take is always, oh God, I really messed up this outline. I'm not going to be able to do this.
Well, how long does it take you? Because the way you do it, it must take forever. So it probably takes forever for you to even imagine what it's going to look like in the end.
Yeah, it takes a while. So my preferred form of drawing is called stippling. It's essentially just dots on dots on dots on dots. So what I do usually is I'll put an outline down, then I'll shade. And usually what I try to do is I try to just do a thin layer so that I can get a better perspective on how the shadows are going to work. And you fill in, and it's just layer by layer by layer. So the portrait I did today, I started it at 11. And
damn,
it's not finished, but I stopped working on it at 7. So yeah, so like 8 hours. So it's probably going to end up being like 10 hours.
That's about how long it takes me to do all of mine, if that's any consolation.
It totally is. All art takes a long time, you know, and especially stylized art takes a long time. And I'm not good at drawing, so
I'm shit at drawing.
Everything takes me a long time. Here's one thing I know, is I am not good at drawing. I can do it.
I can't draw realistically at all. People get mad when I say that, but it's true. I need a lot of help.
Yeah, and generally when I do portraits and stuff, I go for realism. But it's always take it with a grain of salt, because I'm like, yeah, I know this is a drawing. I'm never going to be one of those people that, I mean, maybe not. I'll knock on wood. Maybe I will be so skilled one day that I can sit there and do the fine details. But now I think it's good enough.
Yeah.
I don't know. What do you think, audience? Comment below.
What is the difference between pointillism and stippling?
So, don't know. In my mind, this is before I'm going to Google it. I'm going to do a fact check. We could do a fact check. So, I think stippling is just black and grays, and think pointillism's color, but that might be wrong. They might be interchangeable. So it says, all right, I got pointillism up on Wikipedia, and it says pointillism is a technique of painting in which small distinct dots of color are applied in patterns to form an image. Stippling, I think stippling is a form of shading.
Yeah, I think
harder process of drawing, painting, or engraving using numerous dots. Okay, so I believe all pointillisms are stippling, but not all stippling is pointillism.
Yeah, that's what I thought. It's like pointillism is a painting made out of many repeated patterns. So it's just like, it could be a bunch of dots. It could be a bunch of paintbrush swipes. But stippling, it's like very thin dots. And the white of the paper shows.
Yes, but I believe I might be wrong. Please, if you know the answer to this, comment below and let us know. We'll give you a thumbs up and a shout out next video. I believe that pointillism is a form of stippling.
Okay.
It says the term pointillism was coined by art critics in the late 1880s to ridicule works of these artists.
Oh, how would that be mean? How
That's
could
so
that
fucked
be?
Up. I don't get it. How is that mean? Yeah, how's that rude? Dude, people's insults in the 1880s were wild. It says,
They're like, I can't believe you invented a new art form. It's super lame. We'll call it pointillism.
That's hilarious. I'm gonna have to like look up more information on that. We'll talk about that next video.
We'll do a whole video.
We actually could. We could totally do a video on pointillism and stippling.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And I could try it.
Yeah, totally. You might. I love it. It's the only thing legit. It's the only way I know how to shade. I've never done shading in a different way. I guess
I can't shade traditionally either. It's so hard. I can't do the whole like smudge thing.
It blows my mind that people are able to do that. But also, it's got to be quicker than what I do.
Oh, yeah. Almost anything is quicker than what you do.
I see, because I see people do it and they make it look so easy. It's like, I don't think even if you look at this, like, I guess you'd say it's like easy, but most people would just be like, ugh, I don't want to deal with that. It's like, people do shading, you know, naturally with what they call it, the little paper smudger and stuff. And they can just like, I'm done. You can do actual like skin tones. Like with mine, it'll always be dots.
Yeah, no color.
No matter, I'm not even talking color. It's a gradation, you know, how smooth you can get that transition into those shadows and those contours. I mean, I guess you could on a big enough canvas. I generally try to do smaller pictures because I can just get through them faster.
Oh, I wanted to ask how big it was.
It's 7 by 5.5.
Oh, okay. Okay, that's about how big I imagined it.
Yeah, that's about as small as I've been able to do a portrait. Although I have to say, I've only done 2 human portraits in my life. Today was my second.
Woohoo!
And Danny DeVito was my first. Thank you.
I challenged Noah to draw Danny DeVito.
And she's inspired me to now do faces, which were so scary that, I mean, I've been drawing for like 4 years now. Never had a desire to do it. With hands, and you're great at hands.
I only draw faces, and lately, I mean, the hands was a break from faces because I wanted to try to animate, but I'm like, shit, I want to draw faces more.
Yeah, there's something really satisfying about grabbing a likeness.
Well, I watched this video on, you know, those like art inspiration videos. It's like how you can become an artist, or like my artistic journey.
Mm-hmm.
I was watching one, and this guy was like, pick one thing, pick one method and one subject, and only do that for a year. And he got super specific. He was like, I drew ibises for a year every day. And I was like, okay, I'll just narrow that down to drawing faces. I won't limit myself to one face.
I don't have that commitment. Hey, I have to, I drag my feet on artwork. I can visualize it, and then I think about how long it's going to take, and I mean, I got weak wrists, you guys. Like, my wrist is like on fire from time I spent today on that. And so it's like, I think about that and I'm like, eh.
Wear a wrist brace to bed.
Should. I need to start wearing it more often. Really bad about wearing it. Like an old man. I'm only 24. Like, come on. So you've been doing self-portraits for a long time.
Yeah. I don't know. I always end up going back to it. Like every few months I'll do a self-portrait, or every moment of improvement. So this quarantine, I've done more self-portraits because I've improved way more. Do you know what I'm trying to say? It's like every...
No, totally.
Yeah.
It's a great way to gauge your progress as an artist.
Yes. You know, there's a lot of purposes of self-portraits, but I think I mostly do it to gauge progress. And it's a great way to allow myself to be more innovative, because if I really don't like to just use stock images and draw those people, or like if you are trying something new and you're drawing somebody else, then it's kind of weird. But if I want to try something new, then I draw myself, and it's perfect because I'm right here. It's like having a perfect art model right at my fingertips, you know?
And that's actually pretty great considering the history of self-portraits in general, because in my research, I found a lot of the reason people did self-portrait was because they had themselves there. They didn't have to hire a model. You know, if you're a poor artist doing anything you can to get by, you can't hire a subject to sit there for 10 hours.
Yeah.
Got yourself. Hopefully you can afford a mirror.
Yeah, I actually did not do very much research on self-portraiture before this.
It's great. I'm glad, because I'm going to sound really fucking smart.
Don't mansplain to me, Noah.
Not, please don't. I'm going to have to cut that out, because our 8 subscribers would be like, this arrogant asshole.
Noah, it's 9.
Yes. Is it 9? Shout out to our new subscriber. That's right. Everyone gets a personalized shout out.
Should we scroll them at the end? Like a lot of people do with their Patreon supporters. We'll just do it with all of our subscribers.
Yeah, that's hilarious. Absolutely. And we should tag them in this video.
Yes. What were we talking about? Self-portrait.
Yes. So I'm actually going through some of your self-portraits right now. A lot of them are very scary.
They're horrifying. I was like, God damn.
Yeah, like a lot of these. I mean, the thing is, if I looked at these, I'd be like, oh, wow. It's dark and evocative. But knowing it's a self-portrait, I'm like, ooh, you're spooky. Why are you so spooky? Why do you see yourself as so spooky?
It's the turmoils of college, you know? And I'm like, my latest one is not like that at all. My latest 4, technically, are not like that at all. They're just really fun.
Yeah, looking at some of your more recent ones, I'm just so impressed at the detail you're able to achieve. So when you do these, do you plan out beforehand, or do you just mark off blocks and then in the blocks you just do whatever you
I pretty feel? Much just do whatever. With the color blocking, it was easy because it's all digital, so I can just like change the color whenever I want. But it is frustrating because in Photoshop, when I dump color into a section, it shaves the outline down by 1 pixel. So if I change the color too many times, it's noticeably thinner outlines, which is just like extremely frustrating.
That's rough.
I mean, it's fine. I'll get over it. It's probably my fault because I just don't know how to use Photoshop yet. But I mean, it's sort of planned, especially with my Sharpie ones, my Sharpie drawings. I use principles of light, kind of. I took a really expensive art class and it was awful, but I learned principles of light. So, I mean, obviously, like, there's light, dark light, medium light, all that stuff. And so I'll look at the portrait. I'll look at my source photo and I'll turn it black and white and then go through.
I do that as well.
Yeah. And then I'll go through and like, I start with the lightest light, which is usually the forehead and the tip of the nose. And then I'll go darker from there. It's roughly planned because of that. Like, I'll blur my eyes to make sure that the patterns work. And I've definitely gotten a lot better at it through time just by practicing.
As with anything.
Yeah.
Gotta practice.
Like, if there's any change in tone or hue, then I'll change the pattern. And I just go gradually. I try to make them patterns so that if I need to go darker, I can just add a cross through them and make them darker. Mm. What I really struggle with is when men have a little amount of hair on their face.
Yes, I was drawing facial hair today and it was so hard.
Yes, because it's like you have to incorporate the texture of the skin as well as the texture of the hair.
Mm-hmm.
And that is so hard. I've tried different patterns. That's why I draw Galloway so much, because he has so much of that area. I need to figure out how to do that.
Yeah, I found drawing facial hair extremely difficult, especially doing the stippling, because what I ended up doing is I ended up just doing like 3 or 4 dots in one direction over and over and then layering it and still kind of able to see through it. But it looks like a more organized pattern than generally how I do the shading, random dots.
Yeah.
And that gives the hair a little bit of structure to it.
Yes, that's good. I'll have to try and figure that out. I use tally marks. That works pretty well.
Yeah. I mean, that's essentially what I'm doing, but with dots.
Before we move on, I wanted to ask you, like, was it weird drawing your own face, or was it a similar feeling to drawing Danny DeVito?
It was weird at first. It's one of those things that when you start doing it and you're already a little bit nervous about it, of course it's going to be weird. You know, I was already like, oh, this is my first time doing a self-portrait, and it's don't really do faces that often. It's like you kind of have to be objective about face when you're drawing it. It's hard to be objective about your own face. You know, like, I got enough insecurities before being like, God, like, oh my God, look at that ring under my eye. And like, ugh, you can see my psoriasis breaking out. But then I was like, you know what? I don't have to draw that. So I just didn't draw all the blemishes on my face. So I kind of like Instagram filtered as I was drawing, which was kind of nice. It was kind of nice to be able to do that. I left in the circles under my eyes because I was like, that's a little too important for definition. But I was like, no, I need to see the big old zit on my nose.
I actually added in blemishes this time. Not the first time I've done that. They kind of just look like freckles in the way I drew, because it's not like I drew it with realistic skin color.
Well, and that's what mine would have looked like too, which would have been fine. But I thought for the exercise of me learning portraits, it's probably better to just smooth everything out anyway.
Yeah, and historically, people do not leave in blemishes. Historically, Renaissance painters would paint people to look better than they actually look.
Yeah, you think these motherfuckers in the 13th and 15th century had perfect skin?
Yeah.
Look, it's 2020 and I can't get perfect skin to save my life, so... Back to the purpose, we kind of touched on it a little bit when we were talking about how you started doing self-portraits, in that it's a great resource to always have with. What are some other reasons that people would do self-portraits?
I think a lot of it's self-identity and trying to figure out how to emote, maybe how to figure out how you're feeling at the time.
Mm-hmm. I think that's with a lot of artists. One of the videos I watched for this was talking about Picasso, and there's self-portrait he does.
Is that your mystery artist?
It's not my mystery artist. This was just in the this is just in what I was learning, but I found it pretty interesting. It's a painting. This might not be the painting, but it's his Man in Blue, where he apparently painted that right after a friend had died.
I love that painting. I don't even have to look it up. I can picture it.
And I believe that's the one. In the comments below, yell at us and tell us how wrong we are. If I didn't, because I didn't write this down. It was him expressing himself after losing someone close to him. So he used a self-portrait as a way to convey his mourning.
I think that there's a blurry line in self-portraiture, because some people might draw something that totally represents how they feel, but it's not necessarily a representation of their physical self. And I'm like, does that count as a self-portrait?
If it's of themselves, then yeah, right? I mean...
Like if it's of their inner turmoil, if it's like a representation of how they feel and who they are without an actual portrayal of their physical self, does it count as a self-portrait?
I believe so. And I mean, even some of the portraits you sent me don't very much represent your physical
body. No, not really.
But they convey how you were feeling at the time. It's yourself. It's of the self. But that begs the question, is all art a self-portrait?
Well, like, does a selfie count as a self-portrait?
Absolutely.
Every single selfie?
Every single selfie, yeah. Well, so only if you take a self-portrait with an actual camera?
My point of view is that a lot of selfies are a misrepresentation of the self, completely void of creativity, inspiration, or originality.
There's plenty of art that's void of creativity.
We'll get originality. Into that next week.
We absolutely can, but I don't think that disqualifies it as being a self-portrait, because the Webster definition of self-portrait. Oh, actually, this is interesting. So the Webster definition of a self-portrait is a portrait of oneself done by oneself. The definition of a portrait, a painting, drawing, photograph, or engraving of a person. Therefore,
technically,
I believe also portrait means of the self or something like that.
Yeah, so, I don't know. You know, when I was looking up, I was trying to figure out who I wanted my mystery artist to be for this podcast, and I just looked up hashtag self-portrait on Instagram to get some ideas, and it was like all selfies.
And that, I can see how that's frustrating, but I don't think it disqualifies.
Yeah, they're still technically self-portraits.
It's still, by definition, is a self-portrait. I believe because photography is an art, they are engaging in art, whether it's, you know, for gratification or this or that. I mean, I don't think that discredits it from being art.
Yeah.
It definitely doesn't discredit it from being a portrait.
Yeah, I guess it's just frustrating that self-portraits can be these incredible representations of identity and inner self, but then in the same category, you have people just trying to get 5,000 likes on Instagram or even selling a product.
Dude, if If the picture I post that I drew today gets 5,000 likes on Instagram, I'm going to lose my mind.
If any of my posts get more than 50 likes, I lose my mind.
Yeah. It's amazing what this little heart reacts will do to your dopamine receptors.
It's not even that for me. Lately, Instagram to me has been like, I do not like the career path I was on prior to quarantine. It was making me miserable. And I think that if I can get a decent Instagram following, I can use that as a tool to sell my art and make a living so that I can do it every day, all day.
As an actor, I had already reserved myself to be poor and focused on the arts. So I get it. And I think absolutely. I think honestly, if you have 10,000 dedicated fans, you can do anything you want.
Yeah.
10,000 people that like you enough to buy your stuff. Great. So that means you get, what, hit 100,000 followers. You can probably live a decent life.
Yeah.
And even if you're not living well, you're living better than being miserable.
Yeah.
I say 100,000 like I have a lot of followers.
You have like 10 times the amount that I do. So.
You just started your
account. Yeah, true. That's true. It's slow going.
I've had around 1,000 followers for over a year now. More like 2 years because I'm bad at posting. Never post.
I'm trying to post every day, but it really limits myself to short-term projects and also working all day, every day.
So. What I've decided to do is I'm just gonna do a complete overhaul of my design, and I have a layout plan. So now I'm just collecting photos so that I can go a long period of posting without being stressed to create content all the time. Because I mean, even in quarantine, I'm busy. I don't know how, but I'm always doing stuff.
Yeah. I thought I did that. Like, I thought that I had stockpiled art, and I did. But by the time I go to post the old art that I've drawn, I'm like, wow, I've improved so much. This isn't a true representation of the skill level I'm at currently, and I don't want to post it.
That's absolutely fair.
Yeah.
And so maybe I need to just get over it, because I know if I'm doing anything, I'm just losing followers and I'm losing interest.
I'm still interested in Poke Boy. Oh, no, it changed.
Yeah, rip Poke Boy. I got out. I'm out. Changed my name. I finally caved, and I'm just artwork by Noah. So more Poke Boy. Poke Boy was old me. Unfortunately, I think Poke Boy's got to stay in college.
Did you not graduate? Oh, I get it.
No, I did graduate.
I'm so dumb. I was like, oh, you're still in college?
No, Poke Boy's still in college.
You left that part of you behind.
Yeah, but all of his hard work is what's gotten me to the skill level I am today. Thanks for being so irresponsible and learning how to draw.
You're talking about Picasso.
I was talking about Picasso.
He's brilliant. Oh my God.
I mean, he is brilliant. I remember in ninth grade, I guess it was the VMFA, they had a big Picasso exhibit. We got out of school to go see it because it was such a big deal.
Oh my God.
It was pretty cool. It definitely had an impact on me, I think, artistically. What's weird is I find myself drawn to realism, abstract, like equally. I either am drawing like a realistic portrait, or I am doing something super abstract that has no true definition.
You said you draw most of your inspiration from Picasso because of his cubism?
Wouldn't say most. No. I think if anything, through more abstract lens would be after cubism, it would be more like abstract expressionism, more like Pollock, a little more.
Ooh.
Wild. A little more just putting feelings on canvas.
Do you think anything that Jackson Pollock did counts as a self-portrait?
Well, yeah. I mean, I don't know offhand. He did a lot of different paintings before he got known for his spatter.
Oh.
I actually find a lot of inspiration from Jackson Pollock artistically, not necessarily the way he lived his life. Like me, he struggled to draw. As we likely are going to be, as a post-depression artist, you know, he started his career in the late 30s. Then, because of the WPA Federal Art Project, through the New Deal program, he was able to actually make living as an artist and grow from there, which I don't expect us to get any grants like that. I haven't seen anything.
We should get a new deal for the Great Depression of Corona.
They absolutely need to start thinking about it. If it ends up being like what the projections are saying, they need to start thinking about this, and let's invest in things like rural arts programs. Because if we're going to need anything after all of this, it's going to be community, you know? And art is one of the greatest healers of community.
Yeah, I cannot wait to go, because one of my goals is to, like, have a stand at an art show. And I'm so excited after this whole thing is over. Just I'll be able to go to an art show and try to sell some of my stuff and make money.
Yeah. And you know, one good thing that is coming out of all of this being locked indoors is people are pursuing arts like they've never been able to before, because they've never been able to before. How many people do you know that are now drawing or painting or baking or cooking or writing plays? And I mean, I do a play reading a week now, and that never happened before this.
Should we reel it in?
Yeah, we should reel it in. Sorry, all nine of you.
Do you want to get into our artist picks?
Yeah, we should do our artist picks. Kelsey and I have decided to do artist picks, where we're going to do some highlights, some artists that we like, related to the topic that we're speaking on. And so I picked Vincent van Gogh, who is a very famous self-portraitist. Vincent van Gogh, or Vincent van Gogh.
I think you're a true artist when you can say it the correct way, unironically. And not even think about it.
No, and what pretentious Americans are we? I mean, I'm going to say Vincent van Gogh because I'm from Virginia. I can't do it. It's not in my blood.
I think it's just funny that with artists, we can like butcher their names and everybody's just like, yeah, if you say it correctly, you're pretentious.
No, I know.
But with anyone else's names, if you say it wrong, then people like correct you. Like you couldn't just go up to your friend, pronounce their name wrong, and then have them be like, it's okay, it's pretentious to say it correctly.
Actually, it's pronounced Jessica, but it's pretentious if you say it that way.
Yeah.
Vincent Wilhelm van Gogh was a Dutch artist. He was very famous for one major incident, which was cutting off his ear, but he did a lot more than that. He's actually, from what I learned, he's actually like a really chill guy. And a lot of historians think that the awful shit that happened in his life, actually him covering up for other people. So like, for instance, he's really famous for the ear thing, but a lot of people think that he's actually just covering his friend Paul Gauguin, who's another artist that he worked with. And apparently they got in some big old fight. That's the night that he cut his ear off. A lot of people think that he's just covering for him because this other guy was like a fencer. He was like a renowned fencer. And like,
what?
And so like, there's a theory that he whapped this dude's ear off. And then Van Gogh, being like the chill homie that he was like, oh, dude, you will get prosecuted cutting my ear off. I'll just pretend I did it. And then he went down and he gave his ear to a local sex worker and was like, take care of this. It's real special.
Oh my God, what?
Yeah, so, I mean, whether he did cut his ear off himself or it was Paul, he did give it to a local sex worker. And he apparently had a pretty good appreciation for sex work, because he's like, true love was a sex worker that he met. And he like raised her kid for a while until bro. So his brother Theo, who was like his number one, like they were best bros. I mean, like Theo is one of the reasons that Van Gogh actually started doing art. I found pretty interesting. I don't think Van Gogh didn't start painting until he was like 26.
That makes me feel better.
It should. And he didn't live very long after that. So, and he got really damn good, but he originally wanted to be a priest. He went to like theology school. He ended up not doing well in theology school because I think he was a little off. Anyway, the poor dude had real bad mommy issues. See, when he was born, actually the name Vincent van Gogh was supposed to be his brother's name, but his brother was born stillborn. So they just reused the name on Vincent. And I think that his mom suffered from depression and mental illness, as he did throughout his life. And so that developed into a lot of trauma for him as he grew up. He was always kind of trying to, maybe he wasn't always trying to be better Van Gogh, but it's probably a little of that. You can't be named after your dead brother and not take it a little personally. He also ended up in mental institution, and also, I mean, that's where he painted Starry Night through the bars of his cell in a mental institution that he checked himself into because he realized he was going crazy.
That's kind of crazy. I did not know that. What an incredible painting to have any amount of obstacles for.
I know. Further talk about possible selflessness. He killed himself. There's some historical evidence to suggest that actually some local kids shot him. There are these like local kids that apparently like would just fuck with him. They talked about how it was really easy to make him mad and they would just bully him. And I think he also was plagued with lots of mental illness, and there wasn't a lot at the time. I mean, he was born in 1853 and died in 1890. So there really wasn't a lot going on in the terms of mental health care back then. So anyway, I think these kids might have accidentally shot him because he was so depressed. He was just like, dude, I didn't do it. And he was like, I shot myself. Because like he apparently carried out all of his art supplies with him to the place that he got shot. He didn't own a handgun. The timelines don't really match up. And also he didn't shoot himself in the head. He got shot in the stomach, like below his heart. So it's like it didn't really add up that he was actually trying to kill himself. But it, like the earlier ear incident, maybe he is just covering for a homie and he was just like a true G, Vincent Van G. But he was famous for doing self-portraits. It sounds like a madman telling a book report. But he was famous for self-portraits. That's why I picked him. Thank you for listening to my book report.
What do you think his self-portraits, I guess, they're just very good. I don't know. His use of color to me is astounding. Like
he's really inspired by impressionists like Manet. And so you can really see that in his self-portraits.
I can see that.
And he started doing some of his more famous works after that impressionist. It was after the impression he took from the impressionist era. And so you can see he brings out a lot more colors. It becomes a lot more vibrant. And also brings in all this like swirly kind of detail, which you can see a lot in Monet's. It's very bright. It's like he pulls the colors up front.
Yeah, that's incredible. He just, I don't know, just his facial expression is very, it's haunting almost.
I believe the picture I sent you is the one where that's after he cut his ear off. So maybe he's a little mad about that.
I will say he does look wounded. He also is very attractive. He's one of those faces that you see so much through history, you don't really associate it with attraction, but he really is.
He's got a very strong jaw, really.
Yes.
I love the color of his beard. It's so gingery.
Yes, it's great. That use of blue-gray in the background and his shirt must have been so difficult.
So close.
All the hues are super close together. And you can see all the brush strokes, even though the hues are so close together. You can differentiate all these little details, but there's not that much change in tone or hue. And that, I mean, he does have outlines on his shirt, but other than that, you can see the wrinkles in the shirt. You can see exactly where it wrinkles around his shoulder, and you can almost see the threads, even like the contour of his clothes.
And a lot of people talk about Vincent van Gogh and his use of absinthe. So supposedly wormwood is a hallucinogen, although I don't think I've ever seen anything to actually support that. But a lot of people point to this kind of flowy nature of his paintings as his obsession with absinthe. But really, I think he just got real fucking drunk a lot. What ended up happening with the absinthe. And I think like a lot of artists, I mean, we talked about Pollock earlier, alcohol and substance abuse in general becomes an integral part of their lives. Because of, I mean, especially for Van Gogh and Pollock, depression.
Yeah, I don't know very much about Pollock or Van Gogh.
We'll have to, I want to do a whole one on Pollock. Told you, I wrote a one-man show about Jackson Pollock in college.
That's awesome.
Love Pollock.
I could learn a lot from that.
Maybe I'll record it and we can post it on the channel.
Ooh.
Teasers. Let us know in the comments below if you want to see me pretend to be Jackson Pollock in my living room.
You could pull it off. You could contour. Get that. You
could shave my head. Smoke cigarettes. Dude, my mom would be pissed if I was smoking cigarettes in the living room. It would beat my ass.
What's that word for when actors like take their role home with them? I'm method acting.
Method
mom.
Acting. Oh, yeah. I had to become an alcoholic because I'm Jackson Pollock. Thank you. I'm here all week.
You want to talk about Frida?
Yeah, let's talk about Frida. I love Frida.
I'm so excited to talk about Frida Kahlo because she, oh my God. Do you ever research an artist? And you're looking at their stuff and it's so brilliant and you're so inspired, but then you're like, I will never be that good. Holy shit. She's just prolific and brilliant. And I don't even know how she did what she did.
Did she do what she did? I assume you're going to tell me. You're not going to leave me on the edge of my seat like that, right?
That's all I was going to say. No, just kidding. A lot of her paintings are super surreal, but she never considered herself a surrealist, which I think is very interesting. But she was a victim to, one website said polio, one website said another genetic deformity, but one of her legs was shorter than the other one. So her whole life, she had a limp. And then at age 18, she was in a car crash and got some horrific injuries. She broke a lot of bones and it caused her to have pain for the rest of her life. And she's actually been quoted saying, there's been two accidents in my life. The first one was that car accident. And the second one was her husband, Diego.
Oh yes, Diego.
Fuck Diego. No, I don't know.
He was like a cheater, right? Weren't they both pretty promiscuous? they were both horny
but it's
people.
Also like she was 22, he was 43. People referred to them as the elephant and the dove, which is a great metaphor for how it is implied their relationship was.
See, a big old dude.
He was pretty big, he was large, but I think it's that plus the dynamic elephant and the dove. She had many miscarriages, which is depicted in a lot of her paintings. I sent four portraits that Frida did to you.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, they're incredible. They're very surreal, especially the one she did after one of her miscarriages at the bottom there. It's like her crinkled up in bed.
Yeah, golly.
Yeah.
What's up with the snail?
Apparently the snail symbolizes how slow the procedures were, how long she was in the hospital for.
One thing I've always loved is how expressionistic she gets with the symbols in her paint.
Yes, and that's why I was like so impressed by her when I was researching. She had really bad health her whole life.
Yeah, on that same painting, that's her pelvis right there, I assume. Not only from birthing, but from that car accident.
Yeah, a lot of her paintings. There's one, I think it's called The Column. And a lot of her paintings depict her with her broken spine showing through her body. She actually, after the car accident, and I can't imagine how supportive her parents must have been to do this, they constructed an apparatus so that she could paint laying in her bed. And they put a mirror on her ceiling so that she would have a constant reference to look at.
I mean, as someone that sometimes can't get out of bed and doesn't want to paint, that's impressive.
Yeah, it's very difficult because a lot of people think, oh, an artist is more inspired when they're in this state of depression or ailment. And for me, I'm like, no, I'm way less inspired when I'm depressed.
Yeah, no. Almost never when I'm feeling low do I feel as creative as I do when I'm feeling well.
And she just did a great job of harnessing. I mean, most of her paintings I've seen were self-portraits.
Yeah, I think if anyone's the captain of self-portraits, it would be her.
And she did such a great job of doing these little variations to her face. I like how she depicts herself with a long neck most of the time, very stretched out. Her two most famous paintings probably that people have seen is the self-portrait with a thorn necklace and a hummingbird, and Las Dos Fridas, the two Fridas. And those both, you know, I can't tell you how many times I've just kind of seen those, you know, if it's flipping through a book. But I never really paid attention. I look at this portrait. In the past, I've been like, yeah, it's Frida Kahlo. But I never looked. That necklace is like digging into her neck and causing her to bleed. And then she's got, in the Las Dos Fridas, it's super symbolic of the two sides of herself and balancing those.
Yeah, and one, you know, one's got the heart of the other, but outside of their chest.
Yeah, they've both, you know, one's got a more deteriorated broken heart, and it's her in like a Victorian wedding gown, and the other one's herself in traditional Mexican garb with a full heart, holding that thing in her hand is actually a very small portrait of Diego.
Wow.
Yeah.
The thing is, they're intrinsically connected, the veins.
Yes, because my first thought was, oh, I thought the one in the wedding dress would hold the portrait of Diego and have this broken heart and all this stuff. But it's like, no, the one with the full heart is holding Diego.
Yeah, she must have loved him.
I think it's just, it's so complex. I think Frida was way ahead of her time. I just was impressed by her incredible sense of identity when I was researching her.
Very powerful person. She had a very strong sense of self-identity.
Yes, she was challenging gender norms. You know, she was having affairs with men and women, and she would wear, you know, suits. She would wear, most oftentimes she would wear long skirts or traditional Mexican garb to cover up the fact that one of her legs was shorter than the other one. But then also, the way she painted herself isn't really in a traditionally beautiful way. And if you look at pictures of her, her unibrow wasn't that bad.
Oh, really?
She exaggerated it and referred to it as looking like the wings of a blackbird. Mm. So I'm like, you go. That's awesome. And I...
Way to own something that most people are insecure about.
Yeah, and she paints herself facial hair, but she is still, even with the facial hair and the unibrow, I still find her incredibly eye-catching and beautiful.
Oh yeah, definitely. She's striking.
Like nowadays, I think she could be a model.
Absolutely.
She's just absolutely beautiful. And I don't know, she's so imaginative. I've been really inspired by surrealist work. And I'm just like, I don't know if I'll be able to paint something like that, you know?
It takes a lot of imagination.
Yeah, it's an incredible imagination and incredible skill because...
Yeah, exactly.
I think most of us can imagine these incredible surreal landscapes, but then you go to draw it and then it looks dumb. Not you, you. I mean the royal you.
No, probably me too.
Yeah, that's pretty much all I have to say about her. It's just the symbol. I think most of her works feature her with like an animal of some sort. And that's kind of cute. It's almost Disney princess-esque in a way. But I know that every single animal has intense symbolism behind it, or they are native. She's very strongly identified with her culture. So she was born in 1907, but she changed her passport birth date to 1910, not because she wanted people to think she was younger, but because she wanted her birthday to be associated with the start of the Mexican Revolution.
Oh, that's badass.
Yeah.
That's badass.
And that just got me thinking, if your pure job, like if what you did in life was to be an artist and that was all you did, how eccentric could you possibly get? I know that I would be super eccentric.
Nutty as
but
hell.
Like I would change a lot. I would do things a lot differently.
Even as someone trying to be an artist, I gotta reserve myself because I'm fucking crazy.
Yeah.
For her to be able to just be like, no, crazy's my thing. I'm eccentric and you're gonna
yeah, really.
Fucking deal with it.
Yeah, but it's like, I think I have always been like, okay, well, you have to have a certain amount of success before you start laying that in. Because at that point, she was an eccentric genius. Hmm. If I started doing that shit, I would just be a crazy person.
Asshole.
Yeah, an asshole.
You look like an asshole.
Oops, I turned my screen off. Oh, I did it again. Sorry. So this is the end of the video.
Please remember to like and subscribe below. We need you to tell your friends. We want 10 friends here. Just 9 of us. Come on.
If you subscribe, we'll have your name scroll at the end of the video.
If you subscribe, we will draw you.
Oh, God.
Limited to the first subscriber after this video.
Yes. Bye.